Hello YouTubers, and today I am going to review a movie called The Drop. So The Drop is a movie directed by Mikhail R. Roskam and stars Tom Hardy, Noomi Rapace, and last but not least, James Gandolfini. And it's also based on the 2009 short story, Animal Rescue. Now the story is about these two guys who has a bar, and these criminals come inside the bar and drop money into a safe. But one day, the bar gets robbed, and this whole story is about who did it and where's the money. But there's another story, and this other story is about this guy who finds a dog who has been abused and is found inside a garbage can, and he also finds this woman, and together, they both take care of the dog. Now, I just gotta say that this movie is really great, and there are a lot of great scenes within the movie. Now, the movie starts with a slow pace, and it takes a while to get adjusted to the story. I was sitting in the theater wondering, okay, I think I understand what's going on. I think I could comprehend that. Okay, now I get what's going on. It's one of those movies where you go into the theater, there is the opening of the movie, and not sure if you understand what's going on in the story. Then finally, you dive into the plot. Because this is a crime and drama film, this movie has a very dark and gritty tone, and I think that really works for a movie like that. The performances were fantastic. Tom Hardy did a great job. James Gandolfini, love his performance. He did awesome. He did a really awesome job in this movie. And I'm sad to say that this is his last performance, and it is just great that he was in a really good movie for his last performance. Now, I have heard few complaints about the accents in this movie. Now, Tom Hardy puts on his Brooklyn accent, which some people say that it sounds fake. But guess what? I don't give a shit. You're just too distracted by the story and what's going on with these characters. The Tom Hardy character is basically about a guy who just wants to put his life back together and has a normal life. And during the movie, he has this great struggle, what's going on, and the challenges that he has to face. I love the cinematography in this movie, and the movie has great symbolism during its scenes. This movie, The Drop, is pretty good. It has a great script, it has a dark tone, the performances were wonderful. I'm gonna give this movie 4 packages of cash out of 5. Guys, if you have time to see it, then I really recommend it. So that's my thoughts about The Drop. Thank you for listening. Thanks. So let me get this straight. First we have Vampire Academy, Divergent, The Fault in Our Stars, If I Stay, The Giver, and now what do we have now? The Maze Runner. You just got to admit, the young adult genre is just taking over. And guess what? There's still more to come. The Maze Runner is a film directed by Wes Ball, who is new to the film industry, new to directing, and is based on the 2009 bestseller novel by James Dashner. Now me, I have read The Maze Runner. There is also The Scorch Trials, The Death Cure, The Kill Order, I've read all of that. And now 5 years later, there's a movie based on the novel, and here we have The Maze Runner. Now for a pretty long time, I was looking forward to seeing this movie, and I got the chance to see it. And I just gotta say that it's pretty good. Now this film has a great beginning. So the film starts with a young man named Thomas, played by Dylan O'Brien, who is put in a maze. And inside the maze is a community of more than 30 guys who has their own rules, they make crops, build things, etc. Also in the maze, there are 2 runners that are sent during the day to run along the maze to find a way out. And during the night, the maze is surrounded by monsters called Grievers. Now according to the novel, the Grievers are these greenish, squishy blobs with spikes, kind of like these ones. I didn't understand how these slugs are that threatening. But in the movie, they're actually robotic half spiders, half scorpions, which I find very intimidating. When I saw them for the first time, it kind of scared me for a short while. So anyways, during the first part of the film, Thomas desperately wanted to know what was behind those walls outside of the maze. And for those who haven't even read the novel, we are actually desperate too. All the young actors in this movie did great. My favorite actors in this film is this guy, Al Amin, who is the boss, the leader of the maze. I love the way he shows Thomas around the maze, the rules, etc. The other one is Will Poulter, who plays the stereotypical bully in this film. I mean, look at him. Look at the way he just pushes the main character to the ground. Huh, I actually find that hilarious. Oh, and there's a chick in this movie. The only one with more than 30 boys in one maze. Wow. She did alright. I just can't face the fact that she kinda looks like Christian Stewart. The maze in this movie looks awesome. It looks exactly how I imagined it while I was reading the book. You got all the vines, you got all the plants. It just looks badass. Even the chase scenes in this movie is pretty entertaining. And for a movie that is called The Maze Runner, that's pretty good. So things seem to be pretty okay until the third act. Now for some people who have read the book, you already know what's going to happen next, so you may not care. But for some who haven't even read the novel, it's going to be pretty disappointing. The film literally gives you full detail about why these teens are trapped in the maze. And the information is just stale. And it's pretty predictable too. Now while I was watching the film, it didn't really bother me. But after coming out of the theater, I was starting to think that maybe the movie shouldn't have said anything in the first place. Now, the difference between a novel and a film is that they both have different results. In a novel, there are things that worked, but in a movie, there's going to be some things that don't work. And for the third act, it just doesn't work. Again, if you read the novel, it's not going to bother you that much. But if you haven't, chances are you're going to be pretty disappointed. And the reason why the movie tells you why these teens are locked in a maze is because there's going to be a sequel. Yay! The Scorch Trials, the movie! Aren't you excited? It could be like Catching Fire, Mockingjay, and Insurgent all over again. So The Maze Runner has some great action scenes, talented actors, but for the ending, I'll have to deduct some marks. So in this case, I'm going to give The Maze Runner 3.5 grievers out of 5. Guys, if you are a fan of The Maze Runner and the other books, then you're going to have pretty fun with this film. But for those who haven't read the books at all, you're still going to have fun. Just be aware of that faulty ending third act. Yeah. So that is my thoughts of The Maze Runner. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way. So, the doll in this movie is basically like Chucky, but the only difference is that she doesn't talk. She sucks, and so does this movie. Annabelle is a movie directed by John R. Leonetti, the same person who was involved in the original Conjuring movie as a cinematographer, and the same person who did Mortal Kombat Annihilation. So years later, he was like, I want to start directing again. So he decided to do a prequel of the beloved Conjuring, Annabelle. Now you remember Conjuring, right? The long shots, the creepy visuals. That movie was scary. And it's one of the scariest movies of its generation. And that is great due to the fact that the horror genre is going flat with its pretentious jump scares and bad acting. And now when I heard that there was going to be a prequel to The Conjuring, I was like, already? You had one awesome movie. Then all of a sudden, 1 year later, you release another one? Will it be like Halloween 4 when it was released in 1988 and then the sequel came out in 1989 and being one of the shittiest movies in the franchise? Well, I'm afraid to tell you guys, but Annabelle was pretty disappointing. It was slow, it was boring, and it wasn't really scary at all. It's basically about the history of the doll and how the whole possession shit started and Yeah. So the movie started with this loving married couple who gets this doll into the home. Then one night, two people enter to their house and try to kill them. The killers get shot by the police and the blood trickles into the doll's eye, bringing it to life. Then the rest of the movie is just the doll doing shit. And it's not interesting, nor that it's not scary. I was waiting for anything to happen, which would be great. But most of the time, I was just simply looking at a movie screen. Yes, there were jump scares there, and there. But for the most part, I was just bored, and it makes you feel like that the movie just forgot how scary The Conjuring was. The actors don't help too. The main lead in this movie, played by... Really? Just because her actual name is the exact name of the title, she is casted in this movie? Whatever. Her character is considered wooden, and so is her husband. These are the characters that you are not going to remember. They do have some good chemistry together, and you believe that they are a married couple, but sadly, these are just bland characters. And they tend to do dumb things too. There was this one scene where the husband leaves a pan of popcorn by an oven, and it lights on fire. Then there was this other scene where this neighbor was screaming inside another house, and instead of calling the police like anybody else would, the husband goes inside the house because he's a man and he loves to do things his own way. And then you get to the final scene of the movie, and it's just disappointing, and I believe it could have been much better. So yeah, the movie's not good. There was actually one scene which I find pretty creepy, and that was the elevator scene, and that's all I could say. Guys, if you really want to see this prequel, I recommend you waiting until it comes on TV, or rent it, or whatever. Cause chances are, you are gonna feel like crap spending $5 to $13 just to be disappointed. But if you are a horror warrior, then maybe you're gonna like it? I don't know. But all I could say, this movie is a letdown to the first movie. Annabelle gets 5 dolls out of 10. And you know what's sad about this year? This year we had the greatest comedy movie of the year, the greatest action movie of the year, the greatest kids movie of the year, the greatest indie movie of the year, the greatest romance movie of the year, the greatest sci-fi movie of the year, but greatest horror film of the year? No. The greatest horror movie of the year so far is sadly, As Above, So Below. At least it was a horror film that got me traumatized a bit. And guess what the rating is in Rotten Tomatoes? Oh yeah. And then you got Oculus, which kind of did things that are different. But other than that, directors who are directing horror movies really need to do better, or else... Yeah. So that is my take of Annabelle. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way. Ladies and gentlemen, this is my reaction to the ending of Gone Girl.
Okay.
Gone Girl is a movie directed by the beloved David Fincher and is based on a novel with the same title, written by Gillian Flynn, and is one of the most anticipated movies that I wanted to see this year, mainly because of the cast and David Fincher. Alien, Seven, The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, all of that. Also, what I liked about the movie was the trailer itself. I love how the trailer doesn't show everything, kind of like The Purge Anarchy or Terminator Salvation. All we know is that the husband wife is missing and he is desperate to find her, while at the same time, people are blaming him for her disappearance and that he might be a murderer. The husband is played by Ben Affleck, and he did a really great job in this film, and so did everybody in this movie. But the person who stole the entire show, the person who made everybody's mouth drop, was Rosamund Pike, who plays the missing wife. Holy Mother of God. This woman, she, let's just say she is not the person who we think she is. I'm definitely not going to tell you, but I'm just going to say that this woman is evil, a narcissist, and a cunt. That's all I'm saying. She is not what you think she is. She is not. Also, there's another actor in this movie whom everybody seems to hate, and that is Tyler Perry. No, not that one. Yes, that's him. He did a fantastic job in this film, and it's pretty shocking, especially for a man who has been criticized for his movies and his performance for a pretty long time. He plays this cool lawyer who defends Affleck from the people who are accusing him. I came into the theater, I had a large popcorn, a large strawberry Fruitopia drink, and fries. That was my dinner. Not expecting what was going to come to me. I didn't read the book, I didn't know the characters deeply. All I did was watch the trailer, and then boom! I'm seeing the movie! I was never bored during the long 2 hours and 30 minutes. During the movie, we are wondering, is the wife dead? Is she alive? Did the husband really kill her? Is he innocent? What? 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 And that is what I really like about this movie. It makes us guess in our minds, and it never keeps us bored. And then all of a sudden, there are these twists that just comes out of nowhere. And you are like, where the hell did that come from? The movie is rude and pretty uncomfortable at times, and has some pretty misandry in it. The Ben Affleck character is a person who just didn't know what the hell happened to his wife. Then you got the media, especially women who are accusing him for murdering his wife. And this all started when he took a picture smiling with his missing wife's poster. And ever since then, things go pretty bad. This movie touches on reality, and things like that do actually happen in real life. And I think this is a film that every mature audience, especially men, should watch and see how this film touches with reality. This film has a really great score, even during the end credits. I immediately got out of the theater when the movie ended because... yeah, I'm gonna talk about the ending for a bit. The ending to the film is something that I didn't really expect. And because of that, it kind of bothered me, and it kind of ruined it for me. And I was starting to get worried that it might affect the ratings for this film. I didn't know if the ending really happened in the novel, or this was just something different. I couldn't decide to give this movie a 7 or an 8, but that ending still bothers me so much. Sorry for being vague, but because this movie is so good, I just have to limit myself. When you see this movie, some of you think that the ending is going to be great, some of you think it's going to be upsetting, like me, so you'd be the judge. So I thought about it for a while. Great plot, plus great cast, plus great score, plus skeptical ending, equals 8 question marks out of 10. Please, people, go and see this movie, especially during a date. It really touches on reality, the truth about marriage, all that stuff. So that's my take of Gone Girl. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way.
You ever hear the expression, the simplest answer is often the correct one?
Actually, I've never found that to be true.
This movie is like non-stop, but the villain is God. Oh, Liam Neeson, I miss you so much. Left Behind is a movie directed by Vic Armstrong, and it's a remake to the 2000 Kirk Hammett version, Left Behind. And it's based on a bestseller. Now, several years ago, I saw the 2000 version of Left Behind, and it was okay, it was aight. It wasn't good, but It was okay. And then there were two sequels, and they suck. And then years later, I heard that there was going to be a reboot, starring Nicolas Cage. Now, when I heard about the remake, I was like, why does there need to be a remake? It's like if the film director decides to do a remake version of Jack Frost. I mean, why do it again? Now, I didn't imagine myself seeing this remake. Then I thought to myself that if I saw the three movies, then I might as well check this one out too. And that is what I exactly did, and it's bad. Okay? It's bad. You want to see this movie? Well, chances are you're going to be pretty disappointed. So, just like in the original, the film is about an apocalypse where half of the population just disappears into thin air. And it's caused by a rapture. You know, a Christian thing. Now, in the original, it was more intense and more chaotic. But in this film, it was slow. Too slow. So basically, there are two things that are going on in this film. And one of them is Nicolas Cage on a plane with passengers who are having a panic attack because of a rapture. And he is trying to land the plane. That's it. Trying to land the plane. Then there is Casey Thompson, who plays a daughter who is running around the streets finding her family. Even though it's obvious that they are not going to come back. And that's it. That's it. And because of this, the movie is dawdling and sluggish. And none of the actors do a good job saving this movie. Nicolas Cage doesn't do much in this film. He's just there, just for the audience to say, "Oh, look, everybody, it's Nicolas Cage, and he's in a Christian movie! Yay!" And then you got the supporting cast. There is a section of the plane, which is first class, and the passengers are just stereotypes. There's an Asian nerd. There's a Muslim guy who is later accused of being a terrorist. Really? A narcissistic businessman. And then you got a grumpy little person from movie 43 who is supposed to be a comic relief? But yeah, the characters do not save the movie. Some of the acting is not good either, and the dialogue is just dull and pretty much cliched. The score in this film is just retarded. There was a scene where a plane was this close of colliding to another plane, and instead of being serious, the background music has this retarded drumming sound. Then there's the rapture scene, and the movie is just inappropriate. So yeah, the movie is pretty much lame and god-awful. Really, it's god-awful. But while I was watching the movie, I felt like that the director, Victor Armstrong, was kind of trying. I mean, he was a stuntman for Harrison Ford in the Indiana Jones films. He was also a stuntman for Timothy Dalton in Flash Gordon and George Lazenby in the 1969 Bond film On Her Majesty's Secret Service, and also Christopher Reeve in the Superman films. So as you can see, he has done a lot as a stuntman. But a director? Nope. You do see the message of the film, but unfortunately, the characters and the plot is just lifeless. Watching this movie is like watching another episode of Mayday, where Nicolas Cage is just in a plane full of passengers, and he's trying to land it during a rapture. And to make things worse, in the end of the film, there is a mention of a sequel. A sequel? A sequel to Left Behind, the remake? How exactly are they going to get all that money back to make a sequel? They better pray for a sequel, because right now, things are not going good. So if you really want to see this movie, then So far, it has 4.1 on IMDb and 2% on Rotten Tomatoes? Really? Holy shoot. I said shoot, alright? Yeah, Left Behind gets 2 Bibles out of 10. So that is 5 thoughts of Left Behind, the remake. Thank you for watching, and if this review saved your life from watching this god-awful film, then that's great. You should really thank yourself. So thank you for watching, and more reviews on the way.
One of these days the sky's gonna break and everything will escape, and I'll know.
This movie kind of reminds me of a film that just came out last month. A family member dies, and siblings have to reunite together, and they have tension with each other. Yep. The Judge is directed by David Dobkin, the same guy who made Wedding Crashers, and now this year, he made The Judge. And it's about this lawyer, played by Robert Downey Jr., and his mother passed away. So he has to go and meet his estranged father, played by Robert Duvall, who is a judge. And their relationship is not the best. They fight, they bicker, so there's a lot of tension between the two. Then suddenly, the judge is accused of murder, so Robert Downey Jr. is in court defending his father. Now, let me ask you a question. Do you have a parent where you have tension between them, but at the same time you want to be there for them? It kind of relates to me and other people, and that is something that I like in movies. Let me give you a clear example. Boyhood. Boyhood is a movie about childhood and growing up. Then you think about your childhood and say, oh yeah, I know, those were the days. Now while I was watching The Judge, I sort of had that feeling, but maybe not entirely. Now, this movie is okay. It's not going to be an Oscar-winning movie, but it's okay. Both actors did fine in the film, and you believe that they are father and son. I mean, not everybody gets along with their parents, so I find their relationship realistic. Yes, they do have some calm moments and good moments a couple of times, and Robert Downey Jr. really tries to defend his father because of a crime he may have committed. Some of the court scenes were good. It wasn't like other court scenes where people are yelling across the room. It was okay. There were two court scenes in this movie that really got my attention because they were really intense. Now I find this film to be pretty sad at times too, because not only the father is in court, but also, this isn't a spoiler, he has this cancer in him, which means his life is on the line. So there are just some scenes that you just feel sorry for him. Kind of reminds me of Gran Torino and, yeah, pretty much. There was one scene where the father was just lying on the bathroom floor, struggling, and his son has to help him. And it's pretty disturbing and gross. Don't worry, I won't tell you the rest. But it shows the reality when it comes to old age and sickness. Kind of like Angels in America, where it shows the reality of AIDS. So, it's quite sad. Now, one of my complaints about this film is the length. Now, last week I was watching Gone Girl, which was 2.5 hours, but that film really got my attention. But in this film, I just feel like that there were extra scenes and characters that didn't need to be there. So therefore, you feel like that things are just dragging on. One example was that there was one scene where Robert Downey Jr. was arguing with his wife, and she never comes back in the film ever again. He also have a daughter too, and there are like 2 or 3 scenes that just didn't need to be there. And then you got a bunch of other scenes and yeah, that's pretty much it. But overall, the movie is worth watching. The scenes with the father and son are interesting at times. The film is not great as I want it to be, but it's watchable. I'm giving this movie 6 gavels out of 10. Not guilty. So that is my views about The Judge. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way.
You and I are finally done.
Oh, we're not done.
So, after the tragic and god-awful I, Frankenstein came into theaters during the dump month of January, It's now Dracula's turn to show the people of the 21st century what he's got on the big screen. Guys, how do you think that's going to turn out? Dracula Untold is a movie directed by Gray Shore. You know Gray Shore, right? Well, I don't, and I don't think anybody does. So yeah, he did Dracula Untold, and now Dracula is back, flying around and shit, fighting and sucking blood. Actually, there wasn't much blood sucking in this movie, to be honest. So basically, it's a movie about Dracula, about where he come from, and how he became Dracula, his story, his background, kinda like Batman Begins. As a matter of fact, both movies are about bats. Batman. And then look! It's Dracula! And he has bats! The only problem is that one film is great and the other film is quite mediocre. And pretty much on the borderline. So Dracula, played by Luke Evans, is actually Vlad the Impaler. You know, the dude who loves to puncture people by the ass and just hangs them up. So he decides to go into the caves. Then this demon sheds his own blood and then orders him to drink it. Then after that, he becomes powerful, kicking ass during battle and all that stuff. Now Evans did pretty fine as Dracula. Then you got the villain played by Dominic Cooper. And he is not a memorable villain. His ultimate goal is to get little boys into war. And Vlad, or Dracula, tries to stop him. So therefore, there's a full-blown war. But the problem is that you need a villain that is memorable. Kinda like Heath Ledger who played the Joker. But the villain in Dracula Untold is just indistinctive. I mean, he's not in many scenes. And when the final scene is there, you just wanna say,
Go get him, Dracula. Yay.
And that is the problem. When the bad things are happening, you want to care, but it's too late, and the emotion is not there. Then you got other characters. Dracula has a son, a wife, and they are forgettable too. Yeah. The thing that I find cool about the movie is, of course, the battle scenes where Dracula is using his bats and his powers to fight the army that is attacking. Kinda reminds me of the Castlevania games, but that could also be a problem at times. And that is the shaky cam. Imagine seeing this movie in 3D. You wouldn't know what the hell is going on. And even the fight scene with the villain was annoying. Then there are a couple of scenes where you're just looking at the movie screen and you just say, come on, that could have been done better. And then a couple of scenes where you're like, I don't understand. Now, for some of you, you'll find this film pretty fun, but for some, you'll probably be dissatisfied. And no, it's not like the original Dracula movies, so don't put that in your head. I personally don't mind, but my number one problem with the film is the characters. They are not memorable, so therefore, you just don't care about them. What the Dark Knight trilogy has that this film doesn't is the characters that you're gonna remember for the rest of your life. You got Batman, Rachel Dawes, Harvey Dent, Commissioner Gordon, Bane, the Joker, all these people and all these actors that you have in your minds. And when shit gets real, you start to get worried and say,
oh man, oh God, oh man, oh God, oh man, oh God, oh man, oh God, oh man.
But in Dracula Untold, I just didn't get that at all. No wonder this film is 1 hour and 30 minutes. So yeah, I find this film mediocre. Fortunately, it's not like I, Frankenstein, but the greatness is just not really there. I was gonna give this film a 7, but then I give this film a 6. And then things keep on changing. But that's what happens, man. Dracula Untold gets 5 bats out of 10. Come on, Dracula, suck more blood, man. That's what you do. That's who you are. So that is my review of Dracula Untold. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way.
The world.
Never forget who I am.
I really needed that. Birdman is a movie starring Michael Keaton, Naomi Watts, Emma Stone, Edward Norton, and more. And it's one of the movies that keep coming into my mind. And it all started when I saw the trailer. And it starts with Keaton floating around in his underwear, running around the streets half naked, having a strange fight with Edward Norton, explosions all around him, and I was like, what the hell is this shit? And at that point, I knew this movie was going to be good. I knew it was going to be something different. And that is what I really, 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 really like about films. People who are looking at this, people who want to be film directors, do something different. We don't need another superhero movie all the time. We do not need to see a movie based on a bestseller all the time, or another sequel all the time. Now, I'm not saying that these movies are bad. They are good, depending. But whenever you see something different, you just want to think about the director, and you think about their style. Like M. Night Shyamalan's panning shot, or Michael Bay's explosion finish. But Birdman? Now this movie, now this is a movie that you should see. Really, I mean, it's just great. So Birdman, it's about a washed up actor who was once famous, who was once a movie star. He used to play this superhero called Birdman, and now he's doing Broadway, hoping that his career picks up. But things don't go his way. He wanted people to remember him. He wants to be the center of attention, which I can relate to at times. And we all want to be the center of attention. And when we see somebody taking your spotlight away, you just want to be like, oh, you motherfucker, give it back. Kind of like a guy who has a crush on this girl, but the girl goes for this other dude. Then he goes home and posts a video about his feelings.
Fucking love you. Fucking love you, babe. Fucking love you. Look.
Please, don't try that at home. Just don't. So anyway, the actors did very excellent with this flick. Edward Norton plays this understudy in a play, and he thinks he's the man of the theater. He's all that. He's an asshole. And he, he's just funny. One of his best performances in a while. Emma Stone, who plays the daughter of Keaton. There was a scene between the two, and it was great. She did a fantastic job as well. But last but not least, Michael Keaton. He did a flawless job. There was one scene where he just blows up in front of a theater critic because she said that she was going to destroy his play by giving him a negative review. And he just explodes by saying that she doesn't care, she hasn't seen the play, and that she's going to give her negative review for no reason. And that is what this movie is all about! It's about issues with critics and blockbusters. And the film did this in an awesome way. Also, there's this voice that Keaton has, and there are some scenes where we can actually see the voice. And what do you know? It's Birdman, the character he used to play. And his voice kind of sounds like something from a Christian Bale Batman movie. But the most thing that blew me away about this film is the cinematography. There are long shots everywhere, everywhere. And it seems like there are no cuts in this film. It's like if the cameraman was filming this production for days without even turning the camera off. I stared at the screen, looking for cuts and how they transition scenes to scenes. And it's just clever. It kind of reminds me of the club scene from Goodfellas or Gravity. Oh, and speaking of Gravity, this movie was filmed by the same guy who made Gravity. Also, I freaking love the score. During most of the score, it's just jazz music with drums and cymbals, and it sounds great. There are actually a few scenes where we spot the people playing the music, and it's just genius. Overall, this movie is something that you really gotta see. Watching this movie is like going to a university class, and the movie is saying, this is the truth about critics. This is the truth about families, Broadway, genres, life. The actors did a golden job. It's funny at times, but you will love it. It's a very strange film. Watch the trailer. Watch the movie. Get your ass into the theaters. Bring your families. Bring the love of your life. Don't illegally download this movie. Be at the freaking theater. 9 out of 10 birds for Birdman. I'm not gonna lie, I was gonna give this movie an 8, because since this film has tried something new, I'm gonna give this film props. And also, I feel like this movie can be sketchy at times, especially the ending. I didn't really understand what happened. I really got to see this again at some time. But this is a wonderful film you really need to see. People are calling it the greatest film of 2014 so far. Please watch this movie. So that is my take of Birdman. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way.
Hey, come on, man. Don't be a dick. Let me get an autograph. Dude, you fucking rock!
That's it. That's it. As of this day forward, I'm never watching the news ever again. Nightcrawler is a movie starring... Who the hell is that? I mean, seriously. Oh, it's Jake Gyllenhaal. Oh, okay. Well, how the hell am I supposed to believe that? Now, the reason why I'm saying this is because while I was watching the movie, I believe this guy was playing a completely different character. I didn't believe I was seeing Jake Gyllenhaal act. I believe I was seeing a different person being something else. And it's just great. And so is this movie. It's fantastic. So Nightcrawler is about this guy played by Jake Gyllenhaal who is completely jobless. He has done some shit in his past. He's not going anywhere. Until one day, he witnesses a crash, and this news cameraman goes and filmed the crash site, and Jake is like, you know what? I wanna do that. So he gets himself a camera, a police radio, film crime scenes, breaks into people's homes, and takes his films to a news station and sells them. Now, let's talk about this guy for a second. I am freaking afraid of this fellow. Immediately in the start of the film, you know that there's something wrong with this dude. I mean, the way he talks, the way he acts, you immediately know that this guy is just off, really off. I'm actually scared of him. He's like the modern version of Norman Bates. And not only that, while he's filming the crime scenes, he just goes too far. And at that point, he's just breaking the law. And on top of that, he has this wild obsession on the news and filming crime scenes over and over and over. Like if a man goes into a train station and films trains for 24 hours. Sometimes he talks in monologues and speeches. And then there are a few scenes where he makes these threats in a very calm way. What if I told you if I somehow lost control and broke your nose like around 5 months ago? And he just wants his way all the time. Then you start to think and say, okay, is this our villain of the film? Our own protagonist? Even though we think this way, we still cheer for him because he is just awesome. And a very, very super intelligent person who has this creepy mentality. Gyllenhaal did very excellent portraying this role. And most of the time, we actually have a very hard time believing that it's actually Gyllenhaal. And that is just awesome. Renny Russo, who plays the news manager of this news network, did a remarkable job too. There was a scene with him and her in a restaurant, and... he just goes off the wall. And it's just a little scary. And the rest of the actors did great. Guys, go and see this movie when you can. You're gonna have really fun with this flick. And it's a very interesting film. especially with Gyllenhaal's performance. And for those who are interested in TV and broadcasting, this film is pretty cool. You're gonna have a pretty fun time, and it may not make you watch the news ever again. Because with Jake Gyllenhaal's performance, it feels like you are watching a horror film. I'm giving this movie 9 video cameras out of 10 for Nightcrawler. Guys, that is my take of Nightcrawler. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way. By the way, I like this retro looking poster. It looks awesome. I really like it. Yeah, more reviews on the way.
I think Lou is inspiring all of us to reach a little higher.
Space and science. Interstellar is a movie directed by Christopher Nolan. Starring Matthew McConaughey, Anne Hathaway, Jessica Chastain, Michael Caine, and all a bunch of famous actors. And once again, one of the most anticipated movies of this year. Ladies and gentlemen, for so long we had been looking forward for this movie. It took me exactly a year to wait, and then finally, here it is. After seeing the trailer and questioning ourselves, because the trailers do not show everything, and I think that's for the best. So not long ago, I got to see this film in IMAX 70mm. The theater was 99% full, and the people were so excited. And now I'm here to tell you the news. Now guys, let me make everything nice and sparkling clear. Go ahead, watch this movie. The first obvious thing I want to talk about is the visuals. It is fantastic. So Interstellar is about Earth, which is now a piece of dog shit. There are dust storms everywhere, food is running out, and eventually, people are going to die. They establish at least some of that in the movie, and it's kind of believable, at least in my opinion. So how the people of Earth is going to solve this problem? Well, send a bunch of people to space, along with McConaughey and Hathaway, and send them to another universe. Find a wealthy planet, and come back saving the Earth. Now, like I've said before, the visuals, it is glorious. And space is fun, right? It is well shot, and if you are planning to see this in IMAX, you're gonna feel like that there are moments that you feel like your seat is floating into space. As long as you are paying attention. Because of course, that is the purpose of IMAX. The score to this movie is just awesome. I love it. When there are intense moments, the speakers go loud and your seats rumble. And not only that, a part of the score sounds so close to 2001 A Space Odyssey with its theme music and its deja vu all over again. For a moment, I felt like I was somehow transported to 1968. Now the acting, it was incredible. Everyone was great. McConaughey did perfect in this role, and as you know, I assume, he has a daughter, and they both separate during the first half of the film. And they really miss each other, and there are tense moments that they communicate by sending videos, and you just believe their relationship. Everyone did great. Anne Hathaway, she was okay. This movie feels like some sort of reboot to 2001 A Space Odyssey with its astronauts, solar system. We even got our robot in our film. And by the way, I just love the design. Okay, now that we got that covered, let's talk about the story. Guys, do you know anything about quantum mechanics? I don't. Okay, here is the problem the movie has. First of all, I like the ideas the film has. It is fantastic. But I think these ideas can hurt the movie as well. What I'm trying to say is that sometimes the movie stops focusing on the story and gets you into this quantum physics thing a little too much. There are equations everywhere, there are expositions riddled all over the film, and then you are in this ball of confusion. Now, don't get me wrong, you can tell what's going on, but you are so confused that you feel like you should go on the internet and search for the summary of the film to understand it. And that is something that we should avoid. So apparently, this is one of those movies that you really gotta pay attention. But unlike Inception, which is a bit complex too, this movie kinda did this in a wrong way. By being over-focused by these equations instead of being focused to the story. A couple of times, you're gonna feel like this. Yeah, then you're gonna wonder to yourself if you like Gravity or this film. The thing about Gravity is that it was just a simple story. Astronauts trapped in space. Objective? Get back to Earth. That's it. In Interstellar, the space is there, but sometimes it can be convoluted, and it feels like you should go back to understand this stuff. And also the parts where Matthew McConaughey gets launched into space is a little rushed. He finds this spaceship with scientists for the first time, then the very next day, he just leaves Earth. Just like that. But what do you know? This movie is almost 3 hours long, so they got to do something about that shit. In conclusion, Interstellar is a great film. Sadly, it's not a perfect film. There are some flaws, but it's very watchable. The characters are great. The score by one of my favorite composers, Hans Zimmer, was awesome. The space scenes, over the chart, bro. But the script is sometimes annoying, and at times you're just gonna be all over the place. Have fun with this film this weekend, and if you like it, buy it on Blu-ray when it comes to DVD. And yes, this is the type of film that is worth an IMAX ticket. Interstellar gets 8 wormholes out of 10. So there you go, that is my opinions of Interstellar. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way. This has been a great year for Marvel. I mean, really. Big Hero 6 is a new recent animated film by the same people who have made films such as Wreck-It Ralph and Frozen, and based on a Marvel comic. And it's about this teenager who lives in a mix-up city of San Francisco and Tokyo. Well, they name it San Francisco. So anyway, he is a robot fighter, using model robots to fight other robots, kind of like BattleBots. So everything seems to be great with him, until something really tragic happens in the film. Somebody dies. It's shocking. And now there's a bad guy out there, who is using eeny-weeny teeny-weeny nanobots as weapons. So how is this bad guy gonna be stopped? Well, the kid has 4 buddies who has some cool inventions, and a cute giant balloon robot named Baymax, who is just awesome. And that is the key word to this review. Awesome. This movie has a great story, has some great characters, great action scenes, themes, and emotions. First and favorite, let's talk about this big fella. I mean, this guy, he's just likable. This robot kinda reminds me of Arnold Schwarzenegger from Terminator 2. He doesn't know any better. He is a medical robot who heals people and all that stuff. But according to his design, you can see the flaws. The thing cannot run, punch, or even kick a door, which I find very humorous. So now he is armored and now he could do all of that. Whenever he speaks, it is hilarious. And he takes things out of context. There was this scene where Baymax accidentally scares the kid out of nowhere, and the kid is like, "Huh, you almost gave me a heart attack." And Baymax is like, "Claire." And the kid is like, "Whoa, not literally." So throughout the movie, the kid teaches him things kind of like John Connor and the Terminator. I mean, this robot, I love him, man. He's awesome. The characters are likable. They both have different personalities, which is helpful in the film. And the villain kind of reminds me of No Face from Spirited Away. The action scenes and the visuals are amazing as well. But one of the most important thing about the film is the emotion. There are other times that we laugh, and then there are other times that we just feel awful about what just happened in the story. And you stay connected to these characters. And when you see them fighting the villain, it just feels good. And you just want to cheer for them. Especially these two. And when things are not going well, you just want to say, Aw, man. Just like How to Train Your Dragon 2, this movie does have some important lessons, this time about death and how to cope with it. And the movie demonstrates this really well. There was one intense moment when we find out the main twist, and things just go really bad, really angry, really sad, and you just can't believe that this is happening. And you just feel so bad for the characters. And you just say, ah no, things just got real. This film is just really brilliant. It might not be as bright as How to Train Your Dragon 2, but this film is definitely watchable. The jokes are funny, the action, the characters, and the script is great. This film is not just for kids, but for adults like me to enjoy. This film is like Terminator 2 and the Avengers smash into one. All you need to do is just downgrade this movie to a PG rating. And there you go, a family movie. Big Hero 6 gets 9 Baymax robots out of 10. So go ahead, see this movie, you're going to have fun. So that's it, that is my take of Big Hero 6. Thank you for watching, more reviews on the way.
What do you say, buddy?
Whee!
Okay, let's get you back in your luggage.
So I went to the screening to this film, and some drunk guy at the auditorium was shouting at the movie theater screen. A bunch of security came to see what was happening, the movie paused, and the audience hanged for 5 minutes. I thought shit was gonna go down, but the drunk guy left the theater while everyone was booing at him. Then the movie played again, and now, here's my review. Dumb and Dumber 2, not the number 2, but literally, T.O. That's it. I wonder why. So anyway, this movie was directed by the Farley brothers, the same dudes who directed the first movie with Jim Carrey and Jeff Daniels, and everyone was just looking forward to this film. Now, I really remember Dumb and Dumber, one of the first Jim Carrey movies I've watched as a little kid. I remember the formula of the film, the imagination scenes, the comedy, the van, which was literally in the sequel for like 1 minute. That's it. But anyways, Dumb and Dumber was a nostalgic movie that audience loved and critics were pretty split. Why? Because of these two. As you know, Dumb and Dumber is dumb. Really, really dumb. It is so dumb, it is funny. And because of the comedic chemistry with these two, and the stupidness that they do, we just root for them. We wanted a continuation with these characters, and then we got this piece of shit. And now, the year of 2014. 20 years later, we got something more decent. Jim Carrey and Jeff Daniels are back, rather than the other characters playing them. Thank goodness. And we are so glad that they are back with the same chemistry as the first film, after all these years. Most of the time, we don't even remember the fact that these guys are old, even though there are some references to that subject. We just believe that these are the same people. So Dumb and Dumber is about Harry, who discovers that he has a daughter. So Floyd and him goes on an adventure to track her down. Shit happens, there are bad guys that are out there to get them, and so on. Like I said before, these guys are great. Both of these guys make you smile. These guys do make you laugh, but not maybe as much as the first film. Now, even though that this film is better than this piece of shit, it didn't have the same level as the first one. It's like Terminator 1 and then Terminator 2, then 3. I mean, it's hard. You cannot keep up with the same level as the first film. Some of the jokes don't work. And in the start of the film, this scene is in the trailer. Floyd is in a hospital for 20 years and reveals to Harry that he was just faking it. And I was like, oh, Okay.
What a waste.
Yeah, so there are some things that they try too hard or do some stuff that doesn't make you laugh that much. The girl in the movie, she's... I didn't find her funny. I mean, this girl, she was fine, but didn't do well with the comedy at all. I could tell that she is trying, but not enough to make you laugh. Also, I feel like this film is kind of like Home Alone 2, where the plot repeats itself from the first film, with the memorable lines, the memorable scenes. It actually felt good seeing that on screen. And you think, oh yeah, now I remember that. But it also make you think and say, I don't know about this, but maybe they should have come up with fresh ideas. So yeah, the film is not all that perfect. It's pretty watchable. You might love it, you might hate it, but I'll guarantee you like it. Jim Carrey and Jeff Daniels act the same way they were in the first film, and it just feels good. The laughs are there, and you'll laugh a lot, but not as much as the first film. I'm gonna give this film 6 puppy bands out of 10. So there you go, that is my take of Dumb and Dumber 2. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way. Last weekend we had Interstellar, Big Hero 6, and now this movie. Ladies and gentlemen, it has been a weekend of science. The Theory of Everything is a movie that is about the life of Stephen Hawking, a biographic film. And this movie basically focused more on his young life and how he was doing during his illness, about his thoughts, his knowledge. But most importantly, this movie focuses on the love story of his wife. It's a love story, basically. I mean, look at the poster. Now, I just got to say that this film is pretty decent. It's not a must-see film, but it's not for everyone. It's just basically for people who just want to know more about this man. It's a learning film with a plot, a true plot, kind of like Get On Up or The Jersey Boys or even Notorious. So in this case, you know how the film is going to progress. To be honest, I was kind of hesitant seeing this movie because I knew it was just going to be basic. When I saw the trailer, I sort of felt good, but nah. I don't think this movie is anything special, really. This movie is strictly for people who just want to know about the smart guy. So I saw it and it was okay. It's beautifully shot, the acting was decent. It's a pretty safe film. Eddie Redmayne plays as Stephen Hawking. He did okay portraying this role of this real person. His wife, played by Felicity Jones, she was aight. She was a pretty calm lady. And these two go through a challenge due to his disability, and you believe that they are a great couple. However, there are some twists and turns in the relationship which will change things. And I really understand that, because if you have a person who has a disability, it can be very hard. And the film demonstrates that pretty good. We go into the film and we just wonder about this man and his theories. And there are symbolism in this film. For example, there are spirals everywhere that represents time and black holes. Kinda like Interstellar. Okay, I'm gonna stop now. There are a couple of scenes that were shot beautifully. There are even some scenes which looks like they were shot from an old video camera, commemorating that this is the past. And it looks like one of those VHS tapes from your 5th birthday. And some of the transitions are good. A couple of fade outs at the right time. And that's all I can say about this movie. It's strictly a biographic film focusing the young life of Stephen Hawking. We know how he got his illness, knows where he get all his great theories, his relationship with his wife. It's a really, really safe film. There are so many scenes where you feel like that things are dragging on and that things are pretty slow. But you kind of know how this film is going to process. Even in the trailer, it feels like you just watched the entire film already, which is bad. Like I said, it's not a film for everyone because you might feel bored, and it's not a must-see film. All I could say, it's pretty safe, and calm film about Stephen Hawking. The Theory of Everything gets 6 black holes out of 10. Black holes, wormholes, time, technology. That is what people are talking about now. Although last week has been the weekend of science. Whatever. So yeah, that is my take of The Theory of Everything. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way.
I said thank you.
Here is a question I need to ask. Why do spectacular movies get a limited release? Ugh, I hate that shit. Whiplash is a movie starring Miles Teller and J.K. Simmons. And I just gotta say that seeing this movie in theaters is one of the best decisions I have made in my life. I mean, this movie did it! I mean, it really did it! All throughout the film, I felt so pumped up, so into the story, and it's just wonderful. So the story is about a young college kid, played by Teller, and all he wants to do in his life is to be a drummer. So one day he meets this composer, played by Simmons, and he is like, you know what kid, come to my class next thing tomorrow morning, and I'll show you the ropes. So he gets to class and, whew, my god. This man crucifies the poor kid. He yells at him, he throws shit at him, he slaps the kid in the face repeatedly, makes him bleed, and then the poor kid is all torn up and traumatized, which takes a troll in his personal life. And now there's this battle in his mind. You know what? Let's talk about Teller for a while. I believe that this movie is about him, even though he's playing a character. When he's out there acting in other movies, he's playing these characters that are not suited for him. So I did a little research to this film, and I discovered that this guy used to be a drummer since he was a child, which means that this is a great role for him. And this movie is about proving to the world that you could be something that you want to be. And in this movie, he's considered the guy in the box, a turtle in a shell. Nobody takes him seriously, and all he wants to be is the greatest, the center of attention. Kind of like Michael Keaton from Birdman, but he's getting bashed so hard and things just get really rough and ugly, and the film doesn't screw around. I mean, this film has some serious themes about life and being what you want to be while there are obstacles at your path. And now, let's talk about this guy for a second. How am I supposed to believe that this guy is the same actor who played J. Jonah Jameson in the Spider-Man films? Do you know who he reminds me of? That damn colonel from Full Metal Jacket. I mean, this guy has his own beliefs, and his beliefs are so radical that it affects the main character of the film and anyone else's, and people are getting traumatized by him. I mean, this guy is my favorite. And he really scares me because I don't know what he's gonna do. I mean, he is really committed to his job that if you do anything wrong, you'll get an ass whooping until you get things right. Both actors did an amazing job in the movie. Also, I love the music in the background, because this movie is all about music too. And I love music so much, and jazz. I mean, just listen to what you're hearing now. Exactly. So whenever I see musical instruments and the rehearsal, it kind of reminds me of high school when I used to play in the school band. So basically, it's like deja vu all over again. Also, the editing is great. One of the most great editing techniques I have seen in a film so far. And not only that, the ending to the film was just awesome. Why is it awesome? Let's just say that our main character got pushed around so hard that he kind of goes Samuel L. Jackson on the composer's ass.
Enough is enough! I have had it with these motherfucking snakes on this motherfucking plane!
The final minutes to the film was so great that the audience clapped and cheered in the end of the film. And man, this film is just wonderful. So, if you have a little theater in your city or in your town that is playing, go ahead and watch this film. It's funny, even though it's mainly serious. Great performance, great music. It's a wonderful film that did things right. And you know what? I think that this may be the best film I have seen so far this year. So therefore, I'm gonna give this film the big one. Are you ready, guys? 10 drum sets out of 10 for Whiplash. So congratulations, this film did it, and I recommend you watching it. This film will blow you away, really. So that is my take on Whiplash. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way. So after watching this film, some random dude gave me 2 random movie passes for the future. And I was like, why, man? And he was like, just take the pass, man. You earned it. Okay. Yay! The Hunger Games: Mockingjay Part 1 is a continuation from the last book and movie, Catching Fire. And Katniss is back, this time in District 13, because a whole bunch of stuff happened, and now she's in a safe place. Now, for those who have read the book or watched the movie, you know what I'm talking about. But for those who are completely lost, then seriously, why are you here? Watch the previous movies, then come back. Get out of here, shoot. So, this movie has turned into a different direction. There are no Hunger Games, it's all political speeches, propaganda, and rebellion, and it's all because of this guy, who is basically a fictional version of Muammar Gaddafi.
Zanga Zanga!
So as far as I can see, everyone is really hyped up about this film. There was even a Hunger Games flag at the front of the theater where I watched the movie.
I'm going this way. I'm gonna walk.
So I came, watched the film, and it was okay, and pretty much. Now, when I watched the first movie, I thought it was pretty good. Some problems, some complaints, but it was okay. Then I saw Catching Fire, which I thought was a bit more better than the first film. Then I saw this film, and I thought the movie did some things that were pretty different, because that is according to the book. Now, as much as I liked the movie, I also thought that this movie could have been much better. Now, here are things that I like. The acting was pretty great. Katniss is much more different than in the previous movies. She's even more innocent, a little more shaken up from the last Hunger Games. And I like the fact that this movie is not all about her. They focus on other people who are suffering and going through a lot of stuff. She still has her badass ways, like shooting down a plane from a sky. But some might complain that she doesn't do much ass kicking. Yeah, there's not a lot of action in this film, and that can be a problem. At times, you're gonna feel like that this film is dragging on. There are a lot of talking scenes, and the film is riddled with Katniss being filmed for commercials, threatening the bad guy that she's coming to get him. Then there are scenes where she's walking around the ruined streets, dead corpses everywhere. They even show some civilians dying, people getting shot and blown up. It's really depressing, and it seems like this movie is trying to get that sorrow feeling from you. But I also feel like that this film was a bit too over the top with this. I was just pretending to wait for Mr. Mackey to pop up from the screen and say,
President Snow is bad, okay? And if you support him, that means you're bad, okay?
Then you got other characters. You got Gale, you got Peeta, who is the main concern of the film, Coin, Boggs, and Plutarch, played by Philip Seymour Hoffman. One of his final roles. The acting was great, but you feel like that these characters are in the film because they were just in the book. As much as they show Katniss not doing much in the film, the other characters are not really that interesting, which might be boring for some. Except for maybe Effie, who was a drag queen chick to a refugee in District 13. And she does have some lines that are pretty funny. Then you got the final act of the film, where everything is going down, and Katniss stays behind. You think that there's going to be an epic action scene, but no. It's just more talking, and it just ends like that. and it makes you feel like they just took a huge chunk of that scene and just shortened it. I mean, come on, the last two films were at least 2 hours and 30 minutes. This movie is only 2 hours, so you feel like things should have been much better. Overall, this movie is okay. I think the reason why this film is so slow is because they are setting up for our next epic sequel for the last movie next year, and you just want more because you know what will happen. I left the theater wondering, I don't know, I think they could have just somehow smashed part 1 and part 2 into one straightforward film. But that's what happens with young and adult films. You got Harry Potter, you got Twilight. Look at the Hobbit films! 3 films in 1 book. Wow! That by saying, if you are a fan of The Hunger Games, you're gonna find this film pretty decent. Like I said, this film has headed to a different direction. No more games, no more tributes, no more arenas. It's all changing to rebellion and revenge. You may be disappointed about the fact that this film doesn't have enough action scenes and the slow pacing. For all the 3 movies I have seen, this is my least favorite. So in this case, 7 Mockingjays for Hunger Games Part 1. Oh jeez. Now I'm pretty scared about Mockingjay Part 2. It's going to be pretty depressing. Really, really depressing. So, that is my take of Mockingjay Part 1. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way. How many times do I need to hear the song Turn Down for What in a movie trailer or in a movie? Sure, it's a good song, but inappropriate for this movie. Horrible Bosses 2 is a sequel to the 2011 successful movie Horrible Bosses, directed by Sean Anders, the same guy who wrote Dumb and Dumber 2, and stars 3 main actors, Jason Bateman, Charlie Day, and Jason... Listen, I'm too drunk to pronounce his name. Just look at the subtitles. So, unlike the first movie where 3 stars decide to kill their own boss, they decide to start their own business thanks to these 3 guys. But guess what? They got screwed over, and now the 3 guys decided to get revenge on them. Now, let me make this nice and sparkling clear. To be honest, I didn't really like the first Horrible Boss movie. I thought it wasn't funny enough, and the sex jokes are just plain offensive. I mean, for example, let's say one person sexually assaults another person, but the genders are in reverse, and it's taken as a joke. It's taken as a joke. And that shit kills me, bro. But what if the roles are changed and the person violates another person? Oh no, that's so bad. But what if the genders are reversed again? Oh, that's not a big deal. He should take it like a man. This is society, and it's supposed to be funny. So aside on that,
I went and saw this movie. I did not have good hopes, and a whole bunch of critics were talking shit about this film. And just like the first movie, I didn't like this movie too. But maybe a bit worse. Why worse? Well, as much as I didn't like the first movie, at least it had a somewhat likable plot. But in this sequel, the plot kinda sucks. And it doesn't help that these sex jokes from the first movies are back with Jennifer Aniston with her bullshit with Charlie Day. But at least there wasn't much of that in this movie, so I guess that was a relief. So who else is in this flick? You got Jamie Foxx, you got Kevin Spacey with his cameos, Chris Pine. These people were not really laughable. I guess the most funniest person in this film is Chris Pine, by a little bit, who had a little fun with this film. And I guess I could put Kevin Spacey in second place. Then finally, you got these three stars in the movie. Now, the thing about these guys is that they are just a bunch of idiots. They are so idiotic that it affects the plot. And you are at the verge of not caring for what is going on with the movie. You are at the point where you're on the phone buying future tickets for the last Hobbit movie. Gee, Smaug is more interesting than these characters. But I gotta admit, this movie made me laugh at least a few times. But not as much as Jennifer Lawrence laughing in Silver Lining fucking Playbook.
I'm just the crazy slut with a dead husband.
So yeah, that's it. This movie is pretty much forgettable and not as funny as you want it to be. Guys, if you really want to see this movie because you are a fan of the first film, then go ahead. Even though I don't recommend it. I mean, this movie, these two movies, they're just not for me. I mean, it's just some old jokes all over again, barely any laughs, and the plot is just not that interesting. I'm gonna give this movie 4 laughs out of 10. Also, as much as they like using the song Turn Down for What, they also have a habit of playing Katy Perry's Roar over and over again. And to be honest, I was listening to that song on my iPod before I even watched this film. What a coincidence. I wish Godzilla came out of nowhere and roared and destroyed some shit. At least that would make me laugh. So guys, that is my take of Horrible Bosses 2. Thank you for watching. More views on the way.
Shut up!
Oh no! White people! White people everywhere! Ah!
Exodus Gods and Kings is a new Ridley Scott movie starring Christian Bale, I'm Batman, and Joel Edgerton. And this movie is about the Bible, the story of Exodus where Moses is in Egypt and he wants his people to go. And there's a bunch of plagues and the Red Sea and Basically, that is what the movie focuses. Now, before this movie was released, there were some ticked off people claiming that the actors were all white instead of Egyptian or something. Now, when I watched the movie, it didn't really bother me that much. I mean, there were some scenes where I completely believed that the cast were Egyptian, but it may have helped if, I don't know, if the casting was a little different. I don't know. I don't care. No big deal. So anyways, Exodus, Gods and Kings. How was it? It was pretty good. The first thing in the film was an epic battle scene with armies everywhere. It was well shot, and the shaky cam was not that shaky, and for the most part it was pretty cool. And then you got the exile scene where Moses leaves Egypt, away from Ramses, and now he has a family and, guys, this is what the movie felt like. I felt like this movie was unbalanced. You got cool scenes like the battle scenes, and you got the awesome but kind of disturbing plague scenes. That was handled well. Then the Red Sea scene. Great, sort of. Then you got the other scenes where the pacing is kind of flat. In the first half of the movie, you're not sure if you're into the story. Then minutes later, you're like, okay, pick it up. Falling asleep here. Then in the second part of the movie, that's where all the plagues are, and finally you're into the story. Which is great, but if you're watching a movie where the pacing has issues, then it will be easy to find some flaws. I don't think this film needs to be 2 hours and 30 minutes. It could have been cut down to help the pacing issue, because aside from the first battle scene, it drags on and on and on. And now the characters. Both Bell and Edgerton did fine as Moses and Ramses, but the thing I really like about Moses is that he is so real. He's not the stereotypical Moses where he's like, "Let my people go." No! He was told by God to let his people go and tell him that he was going to send plagues, and Moses, he doesn't want to go through that. He doesn't want to be held responsible for this. And he goes through this battle with God, and I really like that. And oh, and speaking of God, God in this movie is not what you think he looks like. He doesn't have a deep voice. He's not like Morgan Freeman in a white suit and says, "Moses, I want you to go into the land of Egypt and tell old Pharaoh to let those poor Hebrews go." No, he's not like that. He's, below 5 feet tall. He's a shorty, that's all I can say. But the problem with the film is that it doesn't have the same aspects as the Prince of Egypt. As you can see, these are two brothers, but there isn't enough screen time to establish that they are brothers. I mean, they look like two people who are just somewhat brothers who suddenly hate each other. In the Prince of Egypt, you can see that they are truly brothers by their emotion. And also, John Turturro in this movie is playing as a pharaoh and... I don't know... I felt like he was some sort of comic relief of some kind. I mean, I never took him seriously and... pretty much. And also, there are some great talented actors like Aaron Paul, Sigourney Weaver who are just in this movie, and they don't really do anything. Kind of like Morgan Freeman in Transcendence. Nothing new. They are just there, but they don't do anything. They're just there and... that's it. But overall, this movie is okay. It's not like Noah where they try to do something unique. It's a traditional, basic live-action storytelling of Moses and the plagues. So if you're up to it, then I say check it out. Good acting, cool action scenes. You probably won't adore this movie so much, but it's worth watching. I'm gonna give this movie 7 pieces of gold out of 10. I mean, what is the deal with gold? I mean, look at the poster. Egypt loves their gold. So yeah, that is my take on Exodus, Gods and Kings. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way. The reason why James Earl Ray killed Martin Luther King was because he watched Planet of the Apes and he feared that it was a black empowerment film. That was an assumption made by Chris Rock. Top 5. No, this isn't a top 5 video or something. This is literally a movie named Top 5, starring Chris Rock, written by Chris Rock, and directed by Chris Rock. Or what is he, Tommy Wiseau now? So anyway, this movie is about a comedian who used to be big. He used to be famous in movies, and everybody was laughing with him until he became an alcoholic. Then he became sober, and nobody takes him seriously anymore because he's not funny. And then he comes to a point where he no longer knows what he wants to be in life and such and such. So basically, this is a black version of Birdman. You got a man who was once famous, and then he is so yesterday. But the difference is, this film has a more comedic flavor. This is a fun and funny movie is what I'm trying to say. In this movie, you got Chris Rock, who is the main star, and then you got Rosario Dawson, who is a journalist who wants to know much about him. And this film tells its story with his flashbacks and interviews, his story about his struggles, and all that, which may be slightly confusing at times. But you are still able to follow the story. Both actors did great in this film. Chris Rock once again will make you laugh. This movie is basically based on him, just like Michael Keaton. And in this movie, you see what society is doing to him. He wants to be the greatest, but because what is happening to him, he's pretty much scared and he doesn't know what to do with his life. And then towards the end of the film, he gets his itch in some way. And it is great how this film done it. Some of the supporting cast, J.B. Smoove. This guy is funny, who has this weird obsession with large women. Leslie Jones is in this movie, and she is also funny, who is this loud and random person. Who else? Cedric the Entertainer. This guy, he is mad funny. In the beginning of the movie, he just steals the show, and you are just there laughing. There are also a lot of cameos in this film, including one person during a prison scene, and yeah, you will laugh. However, as much as this film is funny, there are some jokes in this movie where it doesn't hit. For example, 22 Jump Street. The jokes in that movie were like this. But in this movie, the jokes were like this. Oops, gotta reload. Alright. Ah, this thing is jammed. Alright. So at one point you're just watching the movie, then the next you would be laughing your ass off. Which I find okay, but... yeah. But overall, this movie is really funny. Chris Rock is in it, and he is funny as hell. And so is the other characters. You will laugh to this film. So far, this film has been praised by many people. So, check it out. 8 laughs out of 10 for Top 5. Oh, the reason why this film is called Top 5 is because it's about people naming their top 5 favorite comedians of all time. I don't really have one because the numbers always change. Do you? So that is my take of Top 5. Thank you for watching. More reviews on the way.
Hey, Dre, you mind if I get some of them hangers, man? I need some wooden hangers. Oh, damn it. They got the lock on them. They got the lock on them. They hip to your boy.
Well, I just came back from Middle Earth. There was fire, a dragon, orcs, elves, dwarfs, swords, bows, and arrows. Well, I guess my vacation ends here. The Hobbit, Battle of the Five Armies. Not there and back again. Battle of the Five Armies is a new and last movie of the Hobbit trilogy, directed by Peter Jackson. And in this movie, this is the shit. Shit has gone real. Elves, dwarves, humans, goblins, orcs, even more orcs. It's all going down. World War Middle Earth. And it's awesome. Awesome. That is it. The last one. One epic show before it's all over. And then we go back to our jobs and whatever. But we still have Christmas, right? So, what is it this time? Well, a shitload of gold is stored in Erebor, and Thorin is all Gollum on himself. He is now obsessed with gold and the Arkenstone that he's trying to find. And on top of that, there are elves that are rushing to Erebor, along with orcs, and the dwarfs want to defend it and their land. And now there's an epic battle. People are getting shot by arrows, getting stabbed, and decapitated by swords. It's basically like the Matrix Revolutions. The only difference is that movie had flaws, and this movie had more logic. And it's also like Return of the King, where it's basically the same thing. So basically, the vast majority of the movie is all fight, fight, fight. Which is great, but... Before I watched this movie, I had this thought. Why couldn't this trilogy be split up into two movies? Wouldn't that be better? And then when I watched the movie and... Yeah, it should have been two freaking movies. And that is what people are saying. It should have might as well be two. I mean, think about it. You got the first movie, The Unexpected Journey, which was all slow and a couple of pointless scenes, but it's getting there. And then you got the seventh movie, The Desolation of Smaug. Still slow, but it's a movie where you finally meet the dragon, Smaug. So it's more of a rising action to a climax. And then finally, you got the last movie, Battle of the Five Armies, where everybody's fighting each other. And then we got our conclusion. Wouldn't that be better? Wouldn't it be better if we had The Unexpected Journey, then have The Desolation of Smaug, then next year, the half of Desolation of Smaug to Battle of the Five Armies? At least it would help with the pacing. And look at this, the movie is only 2 hours and 24 minutes. It could at least fill it up for 2 hours and 45 minutes or something, kind of like the other movies. But wait a minute, the other movies were at least 2 hours and 45 minutes. Now how would that work if they were combined into 2 movies? I don't know. The action scenes in this movie were fantastic. You know what's going on. It's not even retarded like the Matrix Revolutions, where the mechs were using bullets to take out the machines, and reinforcements used energy weapons just to deliver bullets to the mechs. And the battle scenes were so fluent. It's not like Alex Cross, where a shaky cam is one of the worst things we have ever seen.
No!
Actors, they were great. Bilbo is back, looking good, being cool with that sword. Thorin is back, and these two have a really good relationship and dialogue in this movie. And Bilbo is concerned about his obsessity with gold and that stone, and he wants to do something about it by helping him. Because Thorin, this man has changed and people are very freaked out. Gandalf? Do I even need to bother to tell how awesome this guy is? Every time somebody mentions him, people go... The rest of the characters, Legolas, Saruman, who was in the movie for a short bit, and then the rest, they were great. The action was great. Drama was great. The romance... just tacky and unnecessary. When I watched this film, I even forgot that there was some romance in the last film. And also, for those who have read the books, some may complain about the fact that there are added characters and other stuff that may mess around with the movie. But guys, look at it this way. It's an adaptation, and things have to be changed. As long as the director is able to tell the story from a book correctly, then the movie is great. And this movie is great too! The trilogy may not be as good as The Lord of the Rings, but it's definitely worth watching. And when it comes out on DVD, you can now watch The Hobbit from start to finish, then Lord of the Rings from start to finish. Two great trilogies will make you feel like you're in Middle Earth again. The Battle of the Five Armies is a great movie to finish off this epic trilogy. I'm gonna give this film 8 Sting Blades out of 10. And now I feel like shit. Now what? It's now over. No more battles, no more Gandalf, no more hobbits, elves, dwarves. It's all over. In a couple of decades, will there be a reboot? And if there is, who will direct it? Nope, 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 not you. You will be at home, retired from your explosion fetish. Or dead. I don't know. So, that is it. That is my review of The Hobbit. The Battle of the Five Armies. Thank you for watching. More views on the way.
Will you follow me? One last time.